If that was the case, why wasn't it mentioned in the petition? And there's a lot of confusions around review petition and the supplemental information, which is interesting because in the document provided today, petitioners state, I think more than once, that the findings of the staff is factually inaccurate. The facts were provided to us in the petition. We have no reason to make up facts. We went by what was submitted to us in the petition. And when it was noted as deficiency, we were told, well, that's not really what we meant. We need something else. In the area of special education, in today's response, they mentioned the fact that in our findings, it was mentioned that there's no other options of special ed services in the event that COE becomes the charter. In their response, they quote a sentence that was provided in the cover sheet. And it stated that, charter school may become an LEA member of a SELPA or enter into a memorandum of understanding. That's not what we're looking for in the special ed section. That was one sentence, and actually, you can become an LEA member of a SELPA and enter into a MOU, so the two aren't mutually exclusive. What we were looking for was a charter school can become an LEA for purposes of special ed, or it can be considered a school of the district. In these scenarios, the charter school's obligations and responsibilities are very different. If you become an LEA, you're on your own with IEPs, implementation, assessments. If you become a district of the school is involved in a lot of the decisions and the assessments, etc. So what we were looking for was, in those scenarios, what the charter school would do, and essentially demonstrating their understanding of the legal requirements of special ed. The special ed section also didn't include all of the legal requirements and to demonstrate that they understand their obligations and requirements of special ed. They're very significant requirements that are missing in there, such as IEP content and assessment. And the same is true for section 504. For both of those, and actually the English learner, we're not sure that the charter school understands its legal obligations. In the area of budget, the first issue was the fact that there was no cash flow, which is required by law, and therefore the budget is incomplete. There was a cash flow document added into the petition after it was denied by the district. We can't consider that because the petition has to be considered as denied, meaning that it has to be the petition that the district denied. In its response, the charter school says that the law says that the county board shall not limit its review to the reasons for denial based on the school district. That isn't our recommendation. Actually, has some findings that the school district didn't. That's not the issue. The issue is that the law requires very clearly that it's the same petition that was denied by the district. And the reason for that is because it's essentially an appeal, and we have to look at the same thing the district did. And if there's new information or a better petition, it's a new petition, and the district should have the opportunity to look at it. So the law on this is pretty clear. So the budget was considered a new petition. The other issues in the budget were the fact that the fundraising amount, there was no explanation for the high numbers in the fundraising amount. And they stated in the petition that last year they collected $35,000. And we questioned that amount because it actually didn't match any of the financial reports we received here at the county office. When we questioned that, in their response today, they said, well, we gave you another enclosure 7D that said $11,900. I don't see that figure in any of the documents they gave me. And this, again, is part of the frustration in the petition review, in that we take something that we saw in the petition and we make a finding based on that. And then we're told, well, no, that's wrong. You're misstating facts. You're only as good as the information you get. And with regards to their fundraising amount, they project out $30,000 in the next 3 years, even though, according to them, they only collected $11,000. So that's triple. we don't know how they're going to collect that money. They have no rationale for it, so it is considered overstated. In the area of lack of reserves, they have no reserve, and they have a seriously low fund balance. Therefore, they're not prepared for any economic uncertainties. They reference a $75,000 savings, which really isn't that much, but there's no documentation to support that. They also, in the response today, state that they have $30,000 and $7,000 in savings. Again, there's no documentation to support that. And our concern is that, in review of the general ledger, there's a possible $143,000 debt. We don't know if it's a debt. It's indicated as a negative receivable, which sounds like a payable. It's very confusing. But we're concerned about the possible debt that the school will be. We're not sure, because a lot of financial documents don't reconcile with each other. But at any rate, they plan on taking on another loan of $280,000. So it appears that they're going to put themselves further into debt when they don't really seem to have any savings. And lastly, their instructional supply budget is alarmingly low. Originally, it was $5,000 for last year, and now they say, well, it's actually $8,000, $8,800, which again, we didn't see that in the original budget, but I'm going to go with that now. If it's $8,800, for 123 students, that's $71 per student. Now, they also say that they have 131 students. I don't know what their enrollment is. But if it's 131 students, it's $67 per student. We're talking about materials and supplies for everything a teacher, a student, and office staff need in the course of their day and the course of the year. We're talking about textbooks, curriculum, art supplies, etc. The average, statewide average, is $367 per student. And the lowest amount for this category in Contra Costa County is $194. It is impossible to fathom how they can operate and provide materials for students and teachers on this amount of money. I've never seen something so low in the school budget. And it's very hard not to connect the low instructional supplies, the lack of